As it relates to the closing, is the Commonwealth requesting more than 30 minutes for the closing, and if so, how much time?
I'd be requesting 45 minutes.
Okay, and are you requesting additional time, Ms. Regan?
Yes, I won't go over 45 minutes, and I may be within the 30 minutes.
All right, and yes. And does the Commonwealth want, in case you are approaching, 45 minutes for me to let you know a couple minutes before, Ms. McDougall?
Yes, sir.
And would you like me to, Ms. Regan? Okay. I think everything else can wait until after the closings then. If we can set it up with, bring the jurors down.
I will, Your Honor.
All right, thank you.
One waiting, may we approach?
Sure. Mr. Lang, just ask Court Officer Gator to wait before he brings anybody in, so I can just make an announcement to the press and to the audience. Thank you. Just want to remind everybody that the only camera that can video and record is the pool camera. The only still photographs would be by the pool camera. Only credentialed members of the media and those registered under SJC Rule 119 may have their cell phones out. All others must have their cell phones put away. Credentialed members of the media and those registered under Rule 119 may not record in any way during the closings with their cell phones or any other device. Everyone, please make sure your cell phones are silenced. As to members of the audience and family members, I have to say that the conduct of the audience and family members involved in this case in the most difficult of circumstances has been exemplary. And I think it shows a deep respect for the jury as their role as the sole and exclusive judges of the facts of this case. I simply remind members of the audience, if at any point in time you believe understandable emotion will interfere with the juror's role as the judges of the facts of this case, that you temporarily step outside. All right, Mr. Gator, they can come in.
This court is now in session. You may be seated.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, and thank you, as I have every morning, for your consistent punctuality. I have a series of questions for all of you. If the answer to any of my questions is yes, please raise your hand. Otherwise, there's no need to respond verbally to any of my questions. Any of the jurors have any difficulty following the instructions of the court not to discuss the case among yourselves or with anybody else? Any of the jurors have any difficulty following the instructions of the court not to do any independent investigation concerning this case and avoiding the information from any source other than within the courtroom? Is there any serious and substantial issue involving your jury duty that you need to alert the court to at this time? None of the jurors have answered affirmatively. The court has made a decision having nothing to do with your role as the sole and exclusive judges of the facts of the case to remove the armed robbery of credit cards from your consideration. You should not in any way consider that in your role as the sole and exclusive judges of the facts of the case as to the indictments before the court. A very brief instruction on closing arguments before we go into closing arguments. Each side has up to 45 minutes for the closing arguments. The important things to keep in mind about closing arguments are as follows. While the lawyers will certainly suggest to you and argue to you as it relates to the credibility of the witnesses, since you are the sole and exclusive judges of the facts of the case, they can't give you their own personal opinion as it relates to credibility of witnesses. So if you hear terms like I think, I feel, I believe, you know that it is the prosecutor may suggest, but they may not tell you what they think of the credibility of the witnesses. Secondly, in order to be able for the lawyers to structure their closing arguments, they will inevitably touch upon the law to give context to their argument. I will instruct you on the law, however, you must accept my instruction, whether you believe or accept those instructions, whether you believe them to be proper or not. Finally, I tell you that the closing arguments may not appeal to emotion, passion, prejudice, or sympathy. Commonwealth bears the burden of proof on each of the indictments by the standard proof of proof beyond reasonable doubt, has the benefit of arguing less. Therefore, we'll hear from Ms. Regan first on behalf of Ms. Chism.
Philip Chism, a kind, smart 14-year-old, committed these terrible acts when he was in the throes of a serious mental illness. Now, before I talk to you about the evidence in this case, I want to acknowledge the pain and terrible grief that Philip Chism's actions caused. Philip Chism's actions took a wonderful person from this world. I told you at the beginning of this case, it's not in question who did these terrible acts. And the evidence has borne me out. Now, each of you was selected from hundreds of jurors during a long empanelment process. And the reason each of you is on this jury is because the court, the prosecutor, the defense, and you were confident that you could decide this case based on the evidence and not the sometimes overwhelming grief and emotion that's filled this courtroom. The defense acknowledges the enormity of this task and thanks you for your commitment to this. Now, the evidence is clear that Philip Chism has suffered from a psychotic disorder, most likely early onset schizophrenia, from the time he was young. Now, what's the evidence of that? Well, first you have the testimony of three experienced psychiatrists, Dr. Dudley, Dr. Dever, and Dr. Jackson. And I'm going to talk about each one of them a little bit and their role in this case. Dr. Dudley is a psychiatrist who's been practicing since the 1970s. He's done many, many forensic evaluations in all sorts of contexts, family court, juvenile court, criminal court, death penalty cases. And he has a thorough, studied approach to his evaluation of a juvenile defendant or an adult defendant. But that's not all that Dr. Dudley brings to this case. Dr. Dudley brings to this case the experience of more than 30 years of treating severely mentally ill teenagers and adults. He's told you that he has treated them for years on end, watching the course of their illness and prescribing them medication and witnessing, observing, and studying their symptoms. This is something that Dr. Kinscherf does not bring. Dr. Kinscherf is a very learned psychologist, and he has done many, many evaluations and many consultations of children and teens with psychosis, but he hasn't done the daily, the weekly, long-term observation of someone who is severely mentally ill. And when you boil this case down, it's important to realize the experience of hallucinations, of auditory hallucinations, of command hallucinations, is an internal experience. And the reason the experts testify is that you, if you choose, can rely on their expert and learned opinion, their evaluation of the credibility of the symptoms. And Dr. Dudley brings years and years of very relevant experience to his evaluation. And he is the person that gave you his opinion that Philip Chism lacked criminal responsibility on October 22nd, 2013. Now, another psychiatrist that testified was Dr. Dever. Now, Dr. Dever did not give an opinion about Philip Chism. She had never met him. She was what we call an educational witness. And what she gave you is the background and the structure for you that would allow you to evaluate Dr. Dudley's testimony and his evaluation of Philip Chism. I think it would be hard to find someone more experienced on psychosis with children than Dr. Dever. She's the head of a clinic at UMass Medical Center where she treats children with psychosis and teenagers with psychosis. This has been the focus of her career. And I'd suggest to you that she knows what she's talking about. The third psychiatrist was Dr. Jackson. Dr. Jackson is a child and adolescent psychiatrist who has spent his career, also since the 1970s, dealing with the sickest children and teenagers that there are, the children that are hospitalized, the teenagers that are hospitalized. And what he brought to this was a lens for you to compare Dr. Dudley's evaluation to. He showed you how careful you have to be, a doctor has to be, when evaluating a very troubled teen. Dr. Jackson knew about the malingering, knew about the exaggeration of symptoms, but he didn't just say, all right, that's enough, consideration done, evaluation done, because he realized that severely mentally ill teenagers and adults don't have the best judgment. They're going to exaggerate. They're in terrible turmoil. So what did he do? He looked behind that inflammatory information and looked at the teenager, looked at the boy. And what did he see? He saw, putting aside the hallucinations, the commands, the delusions, he saw other significant symptoms. He saw disorganization of thought. He saw flat affect. He saw social withdrawal. And he treated those things with an antipsychotic medication, risperidone. This was not that long ago. And what happened? There was a marked change in Philip, not based on Philip Chism's report, but based on Dr. Jackson's observations of him every working day while he was in the hospital, about 20 days. Now, Dr. Dudley's opinion you saw Dr. Dudley on the stand, and you saw that he was a considered person who brought a serious perspective to his evaluation of Philip Chism. And he told you that the most important part of his evaluation was his interviews with Philip. 7 interviews over a number of months, 2 to 4 hours in length. Now, you don't have to rely on Dr. Dudley's opinion that the interview is an important part of the evaluation, because Dr. DeVere told you that interviews are the most important part of her evaluation too. And Dr. Dudley, when he interviewed Philip, didn't just take Philip on his at his word. He spoke to Philip Chism about his childhood, his history, the significant events. He observed his mental functioning, observed his moods, observed his physical symptoms. He listened carefully to what Philip Chism had to say about the hallucinations, about the command hallucinations. And he evaluated it against his experience and his knowledge. And then he took that evaluation and he compared it and evaluated in light of all the material that he had. He didn't just take Philip at his word. He had a nuanced approach, and he looked at 25 or more interviews of people that knew Philip in Tennessee. Interviews of the students that were around Philip when he was at Danvers High School. Records concerning Philip. He spoke at length with Philip's mother. He spoke at length with a social worker that worked with Philip after the event when he was in custody. He looked at the police reports. He looked at the videos. He didn't visit the scene and walk through it, but he gave a very careful consideration to everything that he had. And what did he find? He found that it was consistent with Philip having a psychotic disorder, most likely early onset schizophrenia. And I'd just like to point out that Dr. Dudley told you that in the interviews he observed what Dr. DeVere called the negative symptoms. Social withdrawal, flat affect, disorganized thinking. But you don't have to rely solely on Dr. Dudley's report of this, because Dr. Jackson saw those same symptoms not too long ago when Philip was in the hospital. Now, how did we come to be here today? How did this happen? If we go through the course of Philip's illness, it will be consistent with what Dr. DeVere told you about psychosis in children. First, Philip Chism was born into a family with a, I'd say, serious and substantial history of severe mental illness. His maternal grandmother and his maternal aunt have multiple hospitalizations for psychotic illness, and you're going to have those records. His grandmother had multiple, many, many electric shock treatment. And you heard from his grandfather that it seemed that the onset of the illness, and his grandmother in particular, and his grandfather's wife, Eduardo, who testified, his wife, that it was sudden, that all of a sudden she was fine and then she wasn't. Well, we know from Dr. DeVere that's not the case. The problem is that the symptoms fester under the surface for a long time until there's an acute episode. And that's what happened to his grandmother, and that's what happened to Philip. Now, Philip began... Dr. Dudley told you that Philip began hearing voices when he was 10 years old. And that's consistent with what Dr. DeVere told you. Dr. DeVere told you that children suffer with these symptoms, the voices, the social withdrawal, the anxiety, the humiliation of the voices, for years without anyone noticing. That's common. And why is that? Why don't children and teens seek help? Well, It's important to think about how a child would view these voices. A child doesn't know any other reality. A child doesn't know what other people's internal experience is. A child doesn't have the knowledge to evaluate what's happening to him, and we all know that many times adults aren't able to cope with this either. And this illness brings terrible fear and shame, and that's what happened to Philip. And you heard from Dr. Dever, this is the usual course. Well, how was Philip able to function so well in Tennessee if he had this terrible illness? Well, we know from Dr. Dudley and Dr. Dever that two things are very important in determining whether a child can cope with early onset schizophrenia, psychosis. And the two things are, one, are they able to distract themselves? Dr. Dever told you that the more intelligent the child, the better they are at hiding their illness, and that these children use sports, they use school, they use keeping busy, they use comic books, they use video games, they use what music, whatever can distract them from the voices in their head. Dr. Dudley told you another very important thing that children use to manage their illness is a support system. And Philip Chism had a great support system in Tennessee. And you heard from some of the people there. Those people that testified loved Philip very much. And the Carters treated him almost like a son. The coach, Claudia Rodriguez, he had people he could turn to. He had a community. He knew a lot of people, and a lot of people knew him and respected him. Unfortunately, the move to Massachusetts was catastrophic for Philip. He lost his entire support system. He was all alone. He had his mother, that was the only adult, and she was doing the best that she could, but she had three kids, all starting in new schools. Now, the stress of the move from Tennessee to Massachusetts to Danvers can't be underestimated. And Dr. Jackson, Dr. Dever, and Dr. Dudley told you that stress can trigger an acute psychotic episode. And it did. Chism was under enormous stress when he started high school at Danvers High School. He was a 14-year-old freshman boy going to a school where he knew no one. He was an unusually tall African-American boy in a predominantly white school who had no place to hide. And in the beginning, he did well. He held it together. He was friendly. He was smiling. He was a success at the soccer team. But as the weeks continued on at Danvers High School, he began to get sicker. He was less able to cope. And it's not surprising that it was the 14, 15-year-old girls that were around him that noticed the change and not the teachers. And what they noticed is that he began to be more socially withdrawn. His affect was flat. He stopped responding to people. He stopped working in groups. These are not dramatic symptoms. And as Dr. Dever told you, they're often not seen as significant, but seen as just teenage angst, what a kid is going through. But what Dr. Dever told you and what Dr. Dudley told you is that when professionals then look back after they have the information of the acute psychotic break, the benefit of it, then they realize just how significant these subtle symptoms were. Now, on the day of the terrible events, Philip was not himself. Gilberto Perez said that he was extremely quiet, that he didn't respond when Miss Ritzer talked to him, that he had his earphones in for the entire class and was drawing. Autumn Ciani, who was in the classroom with Philip and Miss Ritzer after school, told you she had never seen Philip the way that he was. He was aggravated. And most importantly, she said that when Ms. Ritzer was talking to him, he was mumbling and talking to himself and looking out the window. The same symptoms, the same behavior that Dr. Dudley brought his experienced eye to. Now, when Philip Chism followed Ms. Ritzer into that bathroom, he was not himself. He was not the kind, smart 14-year-old boy. He was totally and absolutely responding to the terrible command hallucinations that were in his head. He didn't choose to do this. Now, just finding that Philip Chism has a mental illness is the inquiry of whether Philip Chism has a serious mental illness or not is not the only inquiry that you have. You also have to decide whether Philip Chism was able to conform his behavior to the law. Now, the first thing you have in that consideration is Dr. Dudley's testimony. Dr. Dudley listened to Philip, talked to Philip about the events, had 7 interviews with him. Dr. Dudley reviewed the reports, how Philip was before, how Philip was after. He talked to his mother, he talked to the clinician, the social worker. He looked to see if the pieces fit together. And what he found was that Philip was in an acute psychotic episode. He was under the command of those hallucinations. But you don't have to just rely on Dr. Dudley's testimony. You can rely on your common sense. How could a 14-year-old boy cope with acute psychotic episode? You heard about the juvenile brain and how the juvenile brain has an effect on teenagers and makes them very different from adults. They have difficulty with making decisions under stress, with controlling their impulses. And Philip was no ordinary 14-year-old boy. He was a 14-year-old boy with the burden of this progressive illness. Now, I have to use notes and I apologize. Now, you also can bring your common sense to Dr. Dudley's opinion. Philip Chism was a loved boy. He was welcomed into the Carter family home. He was the calm anchor on a soccer team full of rambunctious kids. And you can ask yourself, what other than an overpowering mental illness could cause Philip Chism to do these acts? Now, the Commonwealth wants you to evaluate Philip Chism's mental illness through a made-for-TV stereotype of mental illness. If someone is acutely psychotic, everyone would notice. But we know that's not necessarily true. Dr. DeVere, with all her experience, said that she could interview an floridly psychotic, acutely psychotic child for 30 minutes and not realize that they were psychotic. The Commonwealth may argue that Philip Chism did well on a history test, so boom, he wasn't mentally ill, he wasn't psychotic, he could control himself. But Dr. Dudley told you that intellect remains. Philip, when he was psychotic, didn't become stupid. And Dr. DeVere told you that the smarter the child, the more apt they are, more able they are to hide it. Now, the Commonwealth may also want you to believe that once someone becomes acutely psychotic, out of touch with reality, responding to command hallucinations, they stay that way. But that's not the truth of the illness. We know that from the doctors that testified. The truth of the matter is that they have children go, and teenagers, they go along on a base level. They have an acute episode, and then they return to the base. And that acute episode can last hours or weeks. So evidence that Philip Chism behaved himself when he was in custody and didn't display any psychotic, overtly psychotic symptoms, doesn't add much to this discussion, because that's not the course of the disease. The Commonwealth may also argue that Philip Chism malingered on those psychological tests, which I'll talk to you a little more about in a little while. Anyway, use your common sense. This is a severely mentally ill teenager under the stress of the realization that he has done these terrible things. The fact that he exaggerates symptoms and doesn't report symptoms as accurately as their tests would want does not mean he's not mentally ill. Mentally ill teenagers make poor decisions just like mentally ill adults and just like regular teenagers. Dr. Heben wrote in her report that these exaggerations, if that's what they were a cry for help. But we didn't hear any of that in her opinionated testimony. But you saw from Dr. Jackson in particular the way that psychological tests and evidence of exaggeration should be considered. And they should be considered as part of the big picture. Now, I want to talk to you about Philip Chism's behavior. Philip Chism's, when we look at his behavior after he left Ms. Ritzer's body in the bathroom, we look at it, it shows the disorganized thought that is the hallmark of psychosis. First, why was he frantically going from place to place in and around the school for an hour and a half after he left the bathroom for the first time? That bathroom wasn't locked. It was covered with blood. Anyone could have walked in. The school wasn't completely empty. You saw that Kevin Hebert was there, Ramsey was there. I'm sure there were other students. Oh, we heard that the cross-country team was practicing, the soccer team was practicing. Anyone could have walked into that bathroom. If Philip Chism, it would be sensible for Philip Chism, given what he had done, to flee the scene, but he didn't. He just wandered in and out and around for a whole hour and a half. And the Commonwealth may say, well, he covered his face. But it made no sense what he did about his face. 1 minute it's covered, 1 minute it's not. In the middle of his time at the school, after leaving Miss Ritzer's body in the woods, he enters the school. He's covered with blood on his pants. He's barefoot. His face is exposed. It makes no sense. About an hour after he leaves Miss Ritzer for the first time in the bathroom, and after he's moved her body to the wooded area, he returns to the girls' bathroom for the third time. What sense does that make? It makes no sense. Now, the Commonwealth might say, oh, well, he knew he was doing wrong. He wasn't psychotic because he hid the body in the woods. Well, first of all, you were able to visit the scene, and you see that it's not very far into the woods. Now, at night, it might not be obvious to someone coming onto the scene that something terrible had happened there. But anyone coming onto the scene in the daytime would know something was wrong. There were bags and clothes and shoes and knapsacks all strewn around. Also, at any time when he was in the woods, just that little bit into the woods, he could have been interrupted. Anyone could have walked into the scene. You heard from one of the students that testified that the cross-country team was practicing that day and that they ran in that woods, that there was a trail there. There were people playing sports in the parking lot all around. He very easily could have been discovered. This was not the clandestine actions that the Commonwealth would have you believe. And what about the scene that he left there? Was that rational? He left his knapsack, his shoes, his socks, his jeans, and even left in the knapsack there was his student ID, his homework with his name on it. This was not a calculated hiding of a crime. This was the act of someone with very disorganized thought. Now, the Commonwealth may talk about his interactions with Ramsey, Escarcia, or Kevin Herbert, and how he didn't seem completely crazy when they talked to him. But we know from Dr. DeVere and from Dr. Dudley that these short kinds of interactions often do not reveal how psychotic a person is. And Ramsey did not say that Philip Chism was fine, normal. He said something was very wrong with Philip. He had never seen Philip like that before. He was sweating, he was frantic, and Ramsey did not know what was wrong. Now, the Commonwealth may talk about the Philip Chism's use of Colleen Ritzer's credit cards as being a sign that he had a plan, he knew what he was doing, he was thinking clearly. But he used those credit cards and just went to a movie at the same place that he used the credit cards. Of course, someone in their right mind would think, my God, they can trace the credit cards. I better get out of here after I use it. But he didn't do that. And then you have the very significant testimony of the Topsfield police officers, which happened quite a few weeks ago. Now, what they told you is Philip was not right when they saw him walking on the side of the road. First of all, does it make any sense for a 14-year-old boy in shorts on a late October night to be walking along Route 1, old Route 1 in the dark? Where was he going? What's there? There's nothing there. It makes no sense. Certainly not a getaway plan. And how did Philip appear to those officers? He appeared to have a flat affect. He appeared to be socially withdrawn. He exhibited the symptoms, the negative symptoms of a psychotic disorder. Now, if you could give me a minute. I want to talk to you about the Commonwealth's experts and the reason you should question their opinions. Dr. Kincher, first, he was ill-served by Dr. Heben. He asked Dr. Heben to evaluate Philip for psychosis and malingering, but Dr. Heben took it upon herself to prove that Philip was a liar. She never got to the psychosis. What her approach was biased and ill-conceived. She met with Philip once for 3 hours, 11:30 to 2:30, no break, no lunch. And during that time, she gave him over 900 questions, true or false, never, sometimes, always. She didn't draw him out. She didn't talk to him. She gave him tests, one right after another. And the selection of the tests was extremely biased. She gave him 7 tests. 5 she used to conclude he was malingering. And the 2 others she just ignored because of the malingering. That's not an objective evaluation. She went in with an agenda. Now, and I also asked her question, I also asked her about specific questions in the test and the MFAST. And you saw how tricky those questions were. And you heard that the MFAST is not, the manual says, do not use it with adolescents. But she used it anyway. And she used a test with that really is based on tricks with a very troubled adolescent under tremendous stress. That's not fair and it's not right. The test that she gave Philip suggests the answers. There were 900 questions of that every one of them suggests the answer. And as Dr. Dudley told you, that is not the approach you want to take because children and teens are easily led. They're easily influenced. But she had none of that. You saw her. She had an agenda. She fulfilled it, and she wasn't backing down by her opinion. And Dr. Kincher's own evaluation is flawed by some of the same flaws of Dr. Hebbins, because he too gave Philip the psychological test that suggests the answer. He gave him, they gave Philip the two tests about disassociative experiences. And again, they were tests where you just had to say to what intensity you had have these symptoms. It wasn't the very careful, non-suggestive approach that Dr. Dudley brought to the evaluation, or that Dr. DeVer would bring, or that Dr. Jackson would bring. It was a result-oriented evaluation. Now, another reason that you should have a doubt about Dr. Kincher's testimony is his explanation about why Philip did these acts makes no sense. He said that Philip was in extreme emotional distress when he did this. But think about your common experience. 14-year-old adolescent boys do get distressed, and they do sometimes get extremely distressed. But what do? When that happens, they paint graffiti on a wall, they get drunk, they don't do their homework, they skip school, and maybe they go so far as to steal a car. But they don't do these bizarre and horrible acts. Something more is going on, and Dr. Kincher missed it. Finally, Dr. Kincher missed the boat. He never really considered just how young Philip Chism was when he did this. If I remember correctly, he testified all on direct and never mentioned a consideration of what it means for a 14-year-old person, boy, to do these things. It was only when I asked him on cross, he said, oh yes, I always consider that. But how does it make sense? How does it make sense that the Philip Chism that everyone knew did these things? It makes no sense at all unless something really, really awful was going on, unless he was suffering from a terrible mental illness. Now, I need to address an area of the evidence that's very difficult to talk about, but necessary to talk about. And I need to really use my notes for this part. The court will instruct you that you may only convict Philip Chism of a crime if the Commonwealth proves each element beyond a reasonable doubt. That emotion can't get in the way. Even your condemnation of the act that Philip committed cannot get in the way. You have to follow the law and put the Commonwealth to the test. And there is one charge, the unnatural rape charge, which Philip Chism did not commit because Colleen Ritzer died in the bathroom. Now, the court is going to instruct you that in order for a rape to occur, Miss Ritzer has to be alive or the alleged rape must occur very closely in time, almost simultaneously with her death. The Commonwealth must prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the alleged rape, the cause, and the cause of death were tied together by a unity of time, place, and circumstance. And for the unnatural rape, the rape with the branch, Miss Ritzer was not alive, and it was not almost simultaneously with her death. And why is that? Well, first, we know that the injuries to her neck were severe. We know at least one of the wounds cut her trachea, her jugular, her carotid, and that that cut, I think it's the D wound, would cause immediate a death and massive bleeding. And we also know where the blood was found in this case. It was found in the bathroom. We heard from the cleaner that there was blood from the last store to the door. He had never seen anything like it. It was a tremendous amount of blood. Now, the Commonwealth may say, well, he could have done some of the injuries in the bathroom and some of the injuries in the woods. But we know, I would suggest that you'll find that the fatal wound was committed in the bathroom, not in the woods where the branch was used. Because there's very little blood in that barrel, and there's very little blood where her body was found. So if you have a reasonable doubt about where Colleen Ritzer died, you must find Philip Chism not guilty of the unnatural rape count. Now, the Commonwealth must prove beyond a reasonable doubt that Philip Chism did not suffer from a mental illness that caused him to be unable to conform his behavior to the law. The defense did not put on and does not argue that he didn't know he was doing wrong. But the Commonwealth must prove beyond a reasonable doubt that Philip Chism was criminally responsible. It's not enough for you to say he probably was, he most likely was, he possibly was. The standard is beyond a reasonable doubt to a moral certainty. This is a really hard case. This is a really painful case to contemplate. But the law gives you guidance. The law says that you must hold the Commonwealth to its burden, you must decide it on the evidence, and if you have a reasonable doubt, you have a duty to acquit. Now, it's your duty to examine every bit of the evidence, every word of testimony, all the exhibits. And after examining all that evidence, if you have one reasonable doubt, it's your duty to acquit. Now, you have to be convinced to a moral certainty, despite the testimony of Dr. DeVere, Dr. Dudley, Dr. Jackson. You have to be convinced beyond a reasonable doubt, despite the Philip Chism's strong family history of psychosis. You have to be convinced beyond a reasonable doubt, despite the lack of any explanation about why this boy would do this thing. You have to be convinced beyond a reasonable doubt that the bizarre nature of the offense doesn't call into question. Mental status. And you have to be convinced beyond a reasonable doubt, despite his erratic behavior, inexplicable behavior, after he left Ms. Ritzer in the bathroom. Well, I have nothing more to say. And at this time, the responsibility of 16-year-old Philip Chism's case passes from my shoulders to you, yours. And I don't get to respond to Ms. McDougall's closing argument, but I'd ask you, when you deliberate, to think about how I would respond. And at the end of this, now, I'm asking you if you would return a verdict of not guilty by reason of lack of criminal responsibility for the juvenile Philip Chism. Thank you.